96.9 FM. Fresh news, smart talk, all day. The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory, glory,
oh,
glory, glory.
Hands to the heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walk through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. I have no clue what you do at 11 o'clock. Well, I think I do. Today is Veterans Day, and so you may be somewhere today celebrating the end of the World War that was ended on the 11th day of the 11th month. I'm told at the 11th hour, and so we commemorate the service of all those that have fallen. And all those who have served in whatever capacity of law enforcement, we say to you today, thank you so much for your service on this Veterans Day. But whatever it is you are doing that isn't that, I'm happy that you decided to do that do and that you have decided to do that do with me. Outside is a wet Thursday. I think that's Jesus' way of telling you that you should go right now, wherever you are in your vehicle. You should point your vehicle toward a food store. You ought to go get yourself 2 pounds of salt beef, 3 pounds of spare rib, 3 pound bag of flour. I see Kermit is laughing. Kermit, I gotta teach these people how to get it done. Get yourself, well, don't worry about that canned piece. That don't go good in soup. Get yourself a decent onion, a can of tomato paste, one of the small bottle of oil. I got to walk y'all through this. You should have salt home. You don't need to carry any of that. Then jump in your car and go down by Miss Laura and find out what all vegetables she have there. And you buy one of each kind. Make sure to get some sweet potato. Get yourself some yams if you have any of those. And then when you're done, you drive somewhere else. I'm going to say more to you. Go down, see Yellow, the conch man. Get yourself some conch. People like dry conch. I don't really fancy dry conch in my soup, but conch is good enough for me, right? And then you drive home, and I want you to make sure you do the work of him that sent you. And you go, and you make a big, big pot of soup. Of course, you have to go and see if you could get yourself a kit of peas, right? And if you soak them now, if you soak the peas them now, by about 3:30 today, they'd be good enough to go in the soup. And by the time today is over, end of business, because this rain, according to weather.com, is going to be all day rain. This is what we colloquially refer to as set rain. And on days when there is set, you know, I miss my grandmother so much. Let me tell you something about my grandmother. If two clouds, Kermit, pass in opposite directions closely enough, my grandmother start cooking soup. It didn't even have to rain. And so I have no clue what it is these new Bahamian women, Bahamian grandmothers, because you can't be a man and be a grandmother, right? I have no clue what they're doing, and they make me nervous, and I wish we could go back to earlier days where automatically rainy days led to soup cooking, all right? I want you all to let the Lord use you all and to go and walk in his purpose today and go cook the soup, all right? Now, I don't know if any of you have had the opportunity to see last week's Guardian, but Sharon Turner had an interesting piece in there that I have agreed with about 80% of, right? Except for the part where she says that men seem to have a difficulty with women in power. I think that part was a bit nonsense. But because my principal, Ms. Gomez at Carlton Francis was a woman. Ms. Archer at T.G. Glover was a woman. And I don't ever recall them having to struggle. Every ministry that I've ever worked in, the permanent secretary was a woman. I think about Ms. Barbara Burrows, quite the iron lady. And so I'm not really sure if I agree that it is a gender thing. But she goes on to talk about classism. And if you know me, I preach the gospel of classism because sometimes we often forget that no matter where we live in this archipelago, no matter how far in the west we move or how tall the wall is in the east we build, I have surmised that we are all but variations off of East Street. So if you haven't lived on East Street, your ma lived there. And if your ma didn't live there, her ma lived there. And if you want to go as far back to say, well, I was born in Crooked Island, well, more than likely when your great-great-great-great-great grandma come off the boat, she was first landed on Farm Road, all right? Or Market Street, which is where they would have been trading the slaves. And so at some point in your life, as a Bahamian, your lineage should have touched some part of or near to or nearby East Street. And so if you're not East Street product, you're East Street adjacent product. All right, and so the article said, the advent of live proceedings of Parliament was a pivotal step in deepening the country's democracy and in making the people's business and legislature accessible to all. Bahamians are able to watch and listen to their representatives observe firsthand how laws are made, and they are often avid spectators of parliamentary debate, which has regrettably deteriorated in quality and substance over the years. Though Bahamians regularly watch and listen to live proceedings of Parliament, many do not know the conventions, rules, and procedures of Parliament or ascertain the reasons that they exist. Much watching does not necessarily make for much understanding. What many Bahamians consider to be unfair or unjust during parliamentary proceedings, for instance, is often not based on a firm understanding of conventions or rules, but on how one feels about the parliamentarian involved or the individual in the chair as Speaker. The Speaker of the House is the presiding officer of the Parliament, who is charged with maintaining order, ensuring that the rights and privileges of all members are preserved, and protecting the rights of the minority. Bamboo Town MP Patricia DeVoe now occupies the august office of House Speaker, and she is only the second female to ascend to this office in the Bahamas, making her election thereto a noteworthy event. All House Speakers are subject to scrutiny and criticism, and DeVoe, of course, can be no exception. But perspective finds the scope and nature of some recent criticisms against DeVoe to be beyond the pale. Moreover, our review of footage of last week's House sittings reveals that accusations of unfair ruling on the part of DeVoe are thus far without merit. The Free National Movement is now in opposition, and like administrations before it that have been kicked out of office, its members are not exactly happy about their new position. It can be hard for some politicians to get over losing power, and the adjustment period can be longer and more difficult for those who are unwilling to accept their new station in life. Nevertheless, the rules, procedures, and conventions of Parliament are what they are, and no member is entitled to more rights than these provisions provide, regardless of what office he or she might have most recently held. During Prime Minister and Minister of Finance Philip Brave Davis's recent communication to Parliament on Government 2021-2022 Supplementary Budget, East Grand Bahama MP Kwesi Thompson sought to interrupt the communication via a point of order, a mechanism in parliamentary debates we will expound on as we proceed. DeVoe denied Thompson's attempt to do this and in the following sitting advised the House that points of order in such cases will be recognized after a government communication is read. Some FNM sought to spin this as the Speaker being unfair to the opposition, but her ruling was sound, as it has been the long-standing practice and tradition of the Parliament that communications by a government minister not be interrupted by points of order. While in government, ministers in the Minister administration benefited from this same long-standing practice, and the rules do not change simply because members are uncomfortable with having to conform to them while in opposition. Points of order are an important facet of parliamentary debate, and their purpose is to call upon the speaker to make a determination about what a member asserts is another member's violation of a House rule. Rule 38.1 of the Rules of Procedure of the House of Assembly states, a member who rises on a point of order shall, when invited by the speaker or chairman to do so, state the infringement of these rules on which his point of order is based and then resume his seat. Rule 38.2 and 3 state, when a point of order has been raised, any member who is then speaking shall resume his seat, and after the point of order has been stated, the speaker or chairman shall rule on it. A member shall not dissent from a ruling by the speaker or chairman except by a substantive motion for that purpose. Rather than utilizing points of order as House rules stipulate, members over the years have sought to use points of order as a mechanism to violate another member's privilege by repeatedly preventing the member from making his or her point in a contribution. Members have also sought to use points of order to merely complain about statements they do not like, rather than to definitively state and demonstrate what rule has been violated by another member. In her communication at the November 3rd sitting, DeVos said, I put all members on notice that you will not be allowed to abuse neither your privilege nor those of another member. Every member has a right to speak in this House. The points of order will not evolve as a weapon to stifle debate or otherwise deprive another member of his right to be respectfully heard. The chair will not allow the points of order of another member to assail the rights of another member. The speaker's statement is not only supported by House rules, but pursues the preservation of members' privilege and establishes what is intended to be proper order during proceedings. Following Davis's communication, Leader of Opposition Business in the House, Sinan's MP, Adrian White, bemoaned that the microphone of FNM MPs were off during the members' communication and called on the speaker to allow their microphones to be on throughout the House's proceedings. White's request is inconsistent with parliamentary practice, as the microphone of all members, government and opposition, remain in the off position throughout a sitting until and unless a member is recognized by the speaker. The speaker is the only House member whose microphone remains in the on position throughout the duration of House proceedings. This is done to ensure that only the member recognized by the speaker is to be heard at any given time, both for the official record of the House and the maintenance of order. Members are given an allotted time with which to make their contribution, their communication, contribution, or statement, and there are occasions when members who do not make efficient use of their time seek to have more time with which to speak. Allowing a member to go beyond his or her allotted time is the sole discretion of the speaker. Last week, Central Grand Bahama MP Iram Lewis made what amounted to a disrespectful protest to the speaker about Yamacraw MP Zane Lightbourne being permitted to go over his allotted time, though Long Island MP Adrian Gibson was not permitted to do so. Perspective reviewed the footage of last week's proceedings, which revealed that not only had opposition leader Dr. Hubert Minnis been granted extra time by the speaker to make his debate contribution, but DeVoe also denied a government member the opportunity to go beyond his allotted timeline. We describe Lewis's manner of protest to the speaker as disrespectful, not only in his tone toward the chair, but because there is an established mechanism in the rules whereby a member is to dissent a ruling of the chair. That mechanism is a substantive motion, which could be either a resolution of condemnation or a resolution of no confidence. Beyond this, members do beg leave of the chair to make suggestions regarding how the speaker might view a matter on the floor, but the same must be done respectfully, recognizing that the authority to make rulings rests solely with the speaker. When DeVoe, in our view, rightfully responded to Lewis's manner of protest by asking him if he is telling her how to do her job, and Lewis responded from his seat in the affirmative, the Central Grand Bahama MP was out of order and disrespecting both the authority of the chair and the person in the chair. DeVoe's admonishment to Lewis to be very careful was, in our view, putting the member on notice that his behavior toward the chair will not be tolerated. While the speaker's authority to order a member removed for disorderly conduct ought to be executed with temperance, the authority nonetheless exists and is affirmed regardless of how a member feels about who occupies the office of Speaker. Regardless of sex, those who occupy high office must serve well. That being said, scrutiny is more intense on a woman in authority than, and the exception is, sorry, that being said, scrutiny is more intense on a woman in authority, and the expectation is she must prove her worth simply because she's female. Responses to the execution of authority by women are invariably colored by societal and religious views about the role of women and what the posture of a woman ought to be. In our September 20th piece, Do the Right Thing, we spoke to the departure from parliamentary convention, which began in the first Christie administration, wherein an MP is put forward for election to House Speaker without having previously served in the parliament. This makes the learning curve for a parliamentary novice turned speaker unduly steep, which in general does not best serve the essential interests of the legislature. During an appearance on Eyewitness program Beyond the Headlines last week, the country's first female House Speaker, Atalia Johnson, categorized recent criticisms of DeVoe as substantively unfair, urging, as a people, we have to give the new speaker an opportunity to settle in. When questioned on whether she believed patriarchal mindsets play some role in the criticisms, Johnson said, absolutely it does, because that is the society in which we live. And quite frankly, on a practical level, it bothered me at first, but after much thought and advice, men I find in powerful positions have a problem accepting women. The same way they interact with the women in their families, they will bring that into the parliament. And you must find a way as speaker to gently advise them that you are a competent, educated, well-rounded person, and you must command the respect of the parliament by your performance. Our observations of criticisms levied at DeVoe, however, go beyond patriarchal views to a denigrating mode of thinking rooted in self-hate, pseudo-elitism, and ideas about social class and pedigree. We note that rather than criticisms being lodged based on fact or knowledge of House rules, most commentary instead centering on DeVoe's style of speaking, her appearance, and her previous work as a food vendor. Whether some Bahamians want to admit it or not, there are conclusions that tend to be drawn about the acceptability and competence of dark-skinned, assertive women with a style not always considered sophisticated by Eurocentric standards. Without knowing what such women bring to the table, there is a tendency to judge them as being unsuited for positions of prominence. It is our observation that beyond politics, which classically taints our perspective, some Bahamians are bent on looking for reasons for DeVoe to be wrong rather than educating themselves on whether her ruling was sound. We are also of the view that too often Bahamians focus on wrong things and are more concerned with form over substance and appearance over aptitude, with a bent toward pretentiousness that causes far too many of us to see ourselves as being above others based on how they look, where they come from, their level of formal education, or in what social circles they are embraced. Our concern with respect to the Speaker of the House is not with her personality, but with whether her ruling are consistent with the House rules and practice, and whether she executes her authority as Speaker in a considered manner and without fear or favor. We do not require her to be demure, prim, or delicate, and she does not need to be liked by us to be deemed effective by us. We require her to be well-prepared, competent, assertive, where necessary, recognizing that whenever a woman must put a man in his place and establish order, some among us will be triggered and take their discomfort and cognitive dissonance out on the woman in authority. Meantime, there are some who have sought to deride DeVoe by presumably in their minds reducing her to being just a hot dog vendor. They ignore that DeVoe served as a senior executive secretary in the Ministry of National Security for 30 years. Put downs about her also being a former food vendor suggest that DeVoe is not worthy to ascend to high office in the parliament, not to mention such comments being rank hypocrisy coming from those who are content to eat packaged meat, but not content to see upward mobility for small business owners who sell them as a part of legitimate enterprise. We have had lawyers, doctors, accountants, and other professionals assume high office in this country. And if these resumes in and of themselves were supposed to translate into exceptional leadership and service, the Bahamas ought to have been light years ahead of where it is today. Regardless of one's trade, being an entrepreneur is noble and is the resume of many current and past parliamentarians. As former Speaker Johnson indicated, we believe that with time, DeVoe will grow into her post and develop more confident with her role as presiding officer, and making correct rulings as she has done thus far is a good start. We urge the new speaker to be given to much study, to be open to sound advice, and to keep always at the forefront her responsibility to ensure that the people's business in the people's house is carried out through the proper functioning of the chamber over which she presides. That was a bit long. Notwithstanding that, though, I think that it was a good read, and I think that it definitely leans in or makes the case that for a long time, we have actually, like Sharon Turner has suggested, used classism to kind of figure out where we will put people, all right? Now, I have a clip from the Parliament of Trinidad that I want to let you hear. And I want to let you see that there's really no difference. They also have a female speaker. And as you know, the now leader of the opposition was a very popular politician. And she now finds herself as leader of the opposition since Prime Minister Rawley has had a two-peat. I imagine that isn't going very well for her. And so let me just let you hear what Parliament is like in Trinidad. Kermit.
Madam Speaker, you have and you handed to the leader of the opposition, member for Coover North and member for Chaguanas East. The announcement has been made, which has provided, I hope, the requisite clarification and guidance.
Madam Speaker, can you advise if May's Parliament still governs this House?
Madam Speaker,
still guides it?
Madam Speaker, what was read there is not an announcement, it's a statement by the Speaker. And if the standard orders are to be
can we proceed?
Madam Speaker, please.
Motion pursuant
to Section 36 of the Constitution.
Madam Speaker, by yourself.
Member for Kearney Central, please take your seat.
Madam Speaker.
Honourable members, on Thursday, October 14, 2021, the Leader of the Opposition and Member for Superior filed a motion with the Office of the Speaker pursuant to Section 36(1)(a) of the Constitution of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Section 36(1)(a) states, the President shall be removed from office where A, a motion that his removal from office should be investigated by a tribunal is proposed in the House of Representatives. I now call upon the member for Superior to propose the motion pursuant to Section 36(1)(a). Leader of the Opposition and member for Superior.
Madam Speaker, just for clarification, you have announced that the Leader of Opposition would be allowed to read her motion. Can you indicate to us if we will have a debate and explanation as we have been asking all morning?
Member for St. Augustine, again, you are another seasoned parliamentarian. I haven't recognized you. I've called on the member for Superior. The guidelines which have been circulated since Tuesday are quite clear, and the announcement was intended to give the clarification which you seek. Member for Superior.
Thank you, Madam Speaker.
for this opportunity to participate in these Section 36 proceedings under the guidelines unilaterally formulated by your good self. Member. These guidelines seem to have forgotten the origin of the word parliament.
Member?
They come from the word par.
Member? Member? I'm on my legs.
Why are we muting the leader of the opposition microphone?
Member for Superior? Member for Superior, would you kindly propose your motion in the text of your motion?
Well, if you put my mic on, I will continue so to do. Is this mic now on? Thank you very much, madam. I'm saying these guidelines done by your good self forgets the word parliament, comes from the word parley, to allow for debate. And before I read the motion, I want to say these guidelines are illegal, null and void. Illegal. Illegal. We participate in these proceedings, the opposition participates in these proceedings under protest. I want to make that very clear. The Section 36 motion, madam, reading the procedure that you have provided to us, again, unilaterally, I will turn to it now. And I read that motion. Whereas Section 35 of the Constitution provides that the president may be removed under Section 36 from office where she, A, willfully violates any provision of the Constitution, or B, behaves in such a way as to bring her office into hatred, ridicule, or contempt. And or C, behaves in a way that endangers the security of the state. And whereas there have been unrefuted reports, A, of recent events at President's House of interference in the selection processes undertaken by the Police Service Commission. And B, that a list of nominees for the Commissioner of Police prepared by the Police Service Commission was recently submitted to the President, and the President refused to notify the House of these nominees. And whereas the President has neglected to publicly address those reports and has otherwise failed to faithfully execute her several duties under the Constitution. And whereas, in the circumstances, the President should be removed from office. Since she A,
willfully violated the provisions of the Constitution securing the independence of the Police Service Commission in the performance of his functions, and also willfully violated Section 123 of the Constitution. B, behaved in such a way as to bring her office into hatred ridicule or contempt and or facilitating interference with the Police Service Commission. And also by proceeding in the circumstances to appoint new members of this Police Service Commission. C, behaved in a way that has resulted in the endangerment of the security of the state through her inactions and failure and or neglect to act. And D, has otherwise failed and or neglected to execute her duties under the Constitution. Be it now resolved that pursuant to Section 36 of the Constitution, a tribunal be established to investigate the removal of Her Excellency Paula Mae Weeks, ORTT, from the office of the president. Madam Speaker, I thank you, and I just
honorable
want to
members,
place under Section 2.
Honorable members, Section 36(1)(b) of the Constitution states, B. The motion states,
Madam Speaker, muting. Why are you muting the leader?
Is it an attempt to silence the opposition?
Is the leader of opposition being muted?
Madam Speaker, is democracy dead in this parliament?
In accordance with the Constitution and the Electoral College regulations.
But it's illegal.
Member, I have rules. I'm not taking conversation from you sitting.
And so you see, sometimes it kind of just gets rowdy in Parliament. You see the Speaker of the House of Assembly in Trinidad and Tobago in the motion to have the President of Trinidad and Tobago removed for having failed to advise the House or the House of Representatives with regards to a report from the Police Services Commission. They are now calling for the removal of the President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago because, you know, they have a republic system, so they have a President and a Prime Minister. And so you see that, just like Adrian White complained about that someone's mic was off, the Speaker in Trinidad and Tobago also has the power to cut your mic off because that person is the presiding officer of the House of Assembly. You see that that person gets to monitor the temperament of the behavior of the people in the parliament. And opposition sides do what opposition sides do. If you got an opportunity to see the video, you would see where, you know, the leader of the opposition tore up the paper and said, These rules that you have circulated, these aren't, you know, they're rubbish and we will not be guided by them. And so if you listen further on, because it's about seven more minutes, they all vote for the resolution before the House of Assembly or the House of Representatives, as they call it. But they vote making special note that they do so under protest. And so I don't know. I don't know if it's just a us thing or if it's a black people thing or if it's a whomever thing. I hear Sharon Turner. I hear her position. I don't know if it's something that's just inbred in all people of color. I'm not exactly sure if I'm going to say that it's a powerful woman thing, though, because I've never stood, except for in traffic court, I have never stood before, and when I was before, hit now his lordship, Andrew Forbes. Other than those two times in my life, I've never stood before a man as a judge. Every single time I've ever stood before a judge, and it's been quite a few times, it has been before a woman judge. And so I don't know. I don't know if, plus I grew up in the Bahamas with Ivy Dumont and Dame Anita Allen. And I've never known those women to have any pushback with their authority. As a matter of fact, for quite some time, names like now Justice Carolina Bethel had become synonymous with power. All right. And so maybe Sharon's onto something. I think it's just flat out classism. I think that it is elitism, pseudo elitism, she calls it. And I think it is just people playing uppity, if you will, why they have a problem with the Speaker of the House of Assembly. I think I'm going to give you all a break. Let's go to a break. 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. Those are my numbers. You can text me on 422-4796 when I return.
At Fidelity, the holidays are all about family, spending time with loved ones, and being thankful for the little things in life. Worrying about bills should be the last thing on your mind, especially during the holidays. Let Fidelity help you get your bills under control. Fidelity can also get you started with a real savings plan that actually pays you interest. The only thing you need to think about is what you will do with the savings in your pocket this Christmas. Now that's what I'm talking about. Fidelity Bank is here for you this holiday season because you are family, and family is important to us.
Hey, did you find the show interesting? Do you want to be a part of the conversation? Well, sponsor Unleashed today. Call 302-2304 or 302-2375 to see which package is right for you. Join Leyvon Miller as he ignites the passion of the next generation by bridging the gap with engaging conversations and innovative ideas. Take action and sponsor Unleashed today at 302-2304 or 302-2375 and be unleashed.
Tips for keeping children healthy. Ensure that children are up to date with their vaccinations, including the flu vaccine. Make sure that your children practice preventative actions such as proper hand washing. Teach them to cover their nose and mouth with tissue or the inner elbow when coughing or sneezing. Encourage them to keep their hands away from their eyes, nose, and mouth. Explain that they should keep their distance from persons who are coughing and sneezing. Keep your children home when they are sick.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
This is Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with me. Leyvon Miller here. It's Guardian Radio, 96.9 FM. That means I'm unleashed on your radio. That also means it's somewhere between 11 and 12 o'clock. The phone lines are now open. You can give me a call, 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. And just in case you all thought I couldn't read, that was quite a bit of a read. You see, I read the whole thing. Then there were like three glitches, and I'm going to work on that a little bit. I refuse to wear my glasses, you know. It's a thing. But because if God wanted me to have glasses, he would have given them to me when I born. The text right here says, I agree with everything except be given the opportunity to grow into her role. Being given the opportunity to grow into her role. We have too many people who crease up in Parliament and Senate needing to grow. No, did you see all the unexpected crisis in the first month of this administration? 1,000 illegal immigrants, the Columbus statue, woman assaulted in jail. Bella, this is no place for a job, for on-the-job learning. Government is vast. Find some other role for the newbies, not captain the ship. Let's take a phone call. Good morning, caller. You're on. I can't hear you, DeWitt.
Hey, you can hear me now?
I can hear you now, yeah.
Hey, what's up?
Mm-hmm.
Hey, Mr. Miller, so, people who have a problem with people who rise up from the bottom, and I use that with the greatest respect, that word bottom, to the top. Okay, in other words, you see the coconut gentleman that gentlemen that sell coconut. What if one day they rise up to be the prime minister?
And there's nothing that stops them from doing that.
That's right. But you know something, Mr. Miller. You know what I don't understand with some of my people in this country called the Bahamas is that people who some people like say, but they come from humble beginnings. Mm-hmm. Humble beginnings with having born in with a gold spoon, I don't call that humble beginnings. Because I come from that experience.
Mm-hmm.
When you come from not having something to rise up to have something, Mr. Miller, that person to me, from a person who comes from a family with something,
mm-hmm.
it makes me feel more better.
Mm-hmm.
Because that person had to strive. You understand? Whether the lady was a food handler or a lunch vendor, look where she is now.
Mm-hmm.
And look where other persons in this country that I know who basically was on the streets, Mr. Miller, I wouldn't call their name,
mm-hmm.
but they are well-known business people. People don't know that. People don't know that. You
mm-hmm.
cannot judge people.
But it's funny though, because if you are an accountant, you work for a businessman.
That's
if you
right.
are a lawyer,
that,
you work for a
you.
Businessman.
Thank you very
no
much.
No matter and what I, your I, degree is, you work for a businessman. So if someone's able to become a businessman, I think that, you know, they ought to clap. You know, Sebastian bemoans the whole notion of needing to go to college. I don't know much lawyers or doctors around here that got more money than
and,
him.
And look what he rise up to
yeah.
as a person in this country.
Yeah.
That
no,
he rise up to the occasion that a lot of people might have doubted him. Even family members and friends might have doubted him.
Mm-hmm.
Doubted him.
Mm-hmm.
But he rise up to be one of the most successfulest businessmen in this country
no,
today.
You're absolutely correct. You're absolutely correct with it. I completely appreciate the point.
All right?
All right. Thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
This one here says... what does it say? Miller, tell Bahamians to license their car now. But is she on? Well,
yes,
my guest is here. Good morning, Madam Speaker. How are you?
Good morning, and I hope you're doing well.
I am. I feel fine. I'm sorry that our schedules didn't allow for you to get in studio this morning, but
well,
we hadn't taken into account that today was actually Veterans Day.
It was, and listen, I must recall those Defense Force officers who were slain and lost their lives.
Mm-hmm.
And we want to remember them.
Yes.
And while today is Remembrance Day, we want to remember all who would have fallen.
Yes.
And in the line of duty and remember them. And so I was paying homage to them. And so my apologies for not showing up at the time I was supposed to show up, but here I am.
And I appreciate you for coming, Madam Speaker. Now, Madam Speaker, I read an article. I don't know if you've had an opportunity to give it a gaze, by Sharon Turner, written in the Guardian about a week ago. That pretty much vindicated the actions from the chair of the speaker in the occasion where some people, namely the member of parliament for Central Grand Bahama, believed that the speaker was being heavy-handed. If I don't know if you had an opportunity to listen to the show on the way over or getting back to the office, but I kind of drew the nexus between what the speaker in the House of Assembly in Trinidad is like versus what
mm-hmm.
the speaker here in the Bahamas is like. And I must admit, there aren't very many differences because there are rules that govern the chair, are there not?
Let me say this.
Mm-hmm.
There are specific rules that govern the chair. And one of the rules is you are managing the house.
Mm-hmm.
And I do believe that sometimes I am treated unfairly in my management because yesterday, let me tell you, I sat back and I sat very easily.
Mm-hmm.
But nobody came to help the chair, as I had to stand to my feet yesterday, Leyvon,
mm-hmm.
And say, listen, I think sometimes the chair is taken advantage of.
Mm.
Predominantly, I am in a space where predominantly men occupy that space.
Yes.
And I realize that as a woman, and I don't like to bring gender into things, but I have to say that in this aspect,
mm-hmm.
don't like for women to set them down.
Mm.
But here I am. I must remember that I have been elected by two different levels.
Right.
One, I was elected to be the Member of Parliament for Bamboo Town.
Correct.
And two, I was elected to be Speaker of the House of Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have dubbed myself the People's Speaker simply
okay.
because I am there to take care of the mandate of the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
Mm-hmm.
And people, and I specifically say, I should have been asked, especially by those who criticize. Why? Don't just look on television and make a perception.
Mm-hmm.
Because there are rules that govern the House of Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And if I give homage to one, that doesn't mean that I have to take that and give it to each and everybody because they ask for time.
Right, it is yours to give.
It is
the speaker's
give.
Discretion.
And I gave it
mm-hmm.
because, one, I gave it to the Honorable Member of Kalani amongst other members in the House of Assembly.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave it because they were talking about what they were going to do to help, one, this country, and two, to move it forward. People wanted to hear that.
Mm-hmm.
But what people do not want to hear, Mr. Miller, is your personal business.
Mm-hmm.
Your personal business is just that. And if you abuse your time by talking about your personal business,
mm-hmm.
then turn around and ask the chair to give you more time,
right.
then I would say no to that. Mm-hmm. I believe that I am very fair, and I am fair on all sides. My chair to the top is very lonely. I sit there alone. Mm-hmm. Nobody tells me what to do. Mm-hmm. I make judgments based on what I'm hearing in the House of Assembly, and if it is in regard to what we are there to do.
Mm-hmm.
And we are there to make bills and pass legislature and make sure that the people of this country are impacted by what it is that we do as we sit in those chairs.
Mm-hmm.
And so I am going to govern. And I am going to bring dignity and decorum to whatever I do. And if they don't like the way I do this, then they are going to have to understand the old way of doing things has ended.
Mm-hmm.
The floor of the House of Assembly will not be used for any display. It will be used for what we are assigned to do. We were elected by a group of people, and we were elected by these people to govern.
Mm-hmm.
And that is what my mantra is. And my mantra is to make sure that each and every member does not take advantage of the people of this country. And that is what I am set out to do, and I will continue to do so. And there will be those who criticize me and bring me under great scrutiny,
mm-hmm.
and my shoulders are broad, and I will take it. But if they ask me, I will give them the reasoning behind it.
I want to give you a small excerpt from the article written by Sharon Turner that was largely about you,
mm-hmm.
but it was. In this part of the article, she spoke about Italia Johnson. It says, during an appearance on Eyewitness News, beyond the headlines, last week, the country's first female House Speaker, Italia Johnson, categorized recent criticisms of DeVoe as substantively unfair, urging, as a people, we have to give the new speaker an opportunity to settle in. She goes on to say, when questioned on whether she believes the patriarchal mindsets play some role in the criticism, Johnson said, absolutely, it does. Because that is the society in which we live in. Do you think you found yourself having a baptism by fire, so to speak, as the Speaker of the House of Assembly? And do you think it is largely because we live in a patriarchal society?
Yes, I would say that.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you something. I think that I was baptized. And if people understand the House of Assembly, and some people do, you know,
mm-hmm.
I won't say to you that those who even criticize me don't understand what is going on.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes they take personal decisions and they talk and they scrutinize the chair.
Mm-hmm.
But I say this to say, the chair has an obligation, and the chair has to live by that obligation. Whether you baptize that chair or not, I have to stand firm, and I will continue to do so. And she understands because she sat in this chair, mm-hmm. and I am only the second woman historically to have sat in this chair. And yes, I feel that we are governed harsher than those that have sat there before us. And so I could say this, look out, continue to scrutinize. I invite you to give me scrutiny as we move forward, because I believe you are fair in your judgment. And I look at the following proceedings based on me giving judgment based on the rules and the procedures that govern that place that we call the Halls of Parliament.
Mm. She goes on in this article at some point, though. She says, it goes on to say here, I'm losing my focus. We spoke to the departure from parliamentary convention, which began in the first Christie administration, wherein an MP is put forward for the election of speaker of House Speaker without having previously served in the Parliament.
Mm-hmm.
This makes the learning curve for parliamentary novice turned speaker unduly steep, which in general does not best serve the essential interests of the legislature. Now, you are a newcomer to the Parliament, but not necessarily a newcomer to politics.
No.
Certainly not a newcomer to public life, having done, I think, quite a bit of a stint in the Ministry of National Security.
Mm-hmm.
So you understand government procedure. The legislature is a bit different, though, because this is the place. This isn't the place that policy is engaged. It is the place that policy is created.
Yes.
What do you think about the statement that having been her use of word a novice to the parliament, now ascending to speaker? How do you feel that makes the learning curve for you? Are you catching it all up, or are there still some parts of it where you do not know possibly how far your authority extends or how much more you could extend it?
Well, let me say this. Mm-hmm. I think that I have really had to catch up real fast to learn how far my ability to govern over the proceedings of the House really extends. But let me say this to say, part of being a good speaker, and any speaker can come back and either engage me or refute this, is having a good House clerk.
Mm-hmm.
The House clerk that I am affixed to has had more than 43 years of sitting in that place called that we call Parliament, and he has, and with that comes experience.
Okay.
So when I was given that opportunity, one of the things that I did was I not only just sat with him, but I have sat with speakers from both sides.
Okay.
I have sat with Alvin Smith, and I've also sat with past speaker Kendall Major, and both of them given me, who are also novices, because Mr. Smith was an educator.
Right.
And Kendall Major is a dentist. He's a physician.
Yeah.
He's a dentist by profession.
Mm-hmm.
So when we talk about novices, I've sat with novices who's given me words of encouragement and advice, and I also sat with the experience of the House clerk.
Okay.
And the House clerk has been guiding me and doing a magnificent job in educating me as to the rules and the procedures, as well as getting me to, providing me, I should say, with the understanding of what I should be doing and what I should not be doing.
Mm.
We sit and we talk every day, from Monday to Friday. The first thing I do before I take the chair is I sit with the House clerk.
Mm-hmm.
And he guides me on the day's proceedings ahead. Now, what he cannot do is help me make decisions as I would have to as I sit in that chair.
Right.
But from the full understanding that I get from my guidance, I am able to move forward. So they've called me a lot of things. Lot of things in the media, except the truth. And one of the things that I did see in the article was the fact that they think that I come as a hot dog vendor.
Right.
And I've never denied it, and I never will. You know why? Because I came up with parents who owned small businesses.
Mm-hmm.
And small businesses got me to where I am today.
Absolutely.
My mother sold cup and salty and candy. That paid my school fee. I never went without my school fees being paid.
Mm-hmm.
And my father, he was a butcher. He had his own little butcher shop.
Mm-hmm.
And that took care of me. And I can say that. And I applaud persons who were entrepreneurs and who became entrepreneurs.
Absolutely.
And so it's almost like they want to disgrace that position.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to hold on to that, because I can say this, that if I have to say that I came from the road to the chair, from the side of the road to the chair, I'm happy to say that.
Sounds like a perfect front cover for your book whenever you decide to write.
Yes, I think it will.
But I am just
excited by this new experience that I am having. And I'm calling that an experience because that's just what it is.
We have about...
And as I move forward with this experience, yes, I will. The human side of me will possibly make mistakes as I move along. But don't challenge me on it. Help to uplift me. And you know, the most criticism that I've seen coming is basically from my own gender. And I often sit and wonder as to why.
It
encouraged. This is historical. We have another woman sitting, and the most women ever in the House of Parliament.
It's funny that you would say that, Madam Speaker. And the reason I want to, because we have about 90 seconds left, the one thing I wanted to find out from you was, you know, we have seen men in the role of Speaker of the House of Assembly so long that I don't know if we appreciate the fact that the deportment of a woman is different. Her candor is different. The way she approaches things is different.
It's different.
She wears emotions on her face. But the office of speaker is supposed to be, it actually is the head of one of the three pillars with which the entire Commonwealth of the Bahamas sits on, right? And so do you think as you grow into your role as speaker, Do you think you will allow your womanness to affect the speakerhood, or do you think the speakership will end up affecting your womanness?
Well, I think, let me say this. I think that I would allow my womanhood mm-hmm. to affect my speakership.
Okay.
Because women are a bit more nurturing and more caring.
Mm-hmm.
But let me say this just to say, and before we end out, while I'm doing that, I will wear the chair. The chair will not wear me.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker. I appreciate you so much. We're out of time. Thank you for definitely calling in. Well, that's my time. I'm flat out. You know my name. It's Leyvon Miller. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Do not move. They have the news. That happens now.
Glory.
Hands to the heavens. No man, no weapon.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. Nassau, Bahamas.